Yes. What it look like out? Trying to show these niggas, man. It's that street fam, man. We rep that. Yeah, I'm with 101 niggas, we Dalmatian doggy beat. And fly with a tongue, so if you feeling froggy, leave. Kermit, you better think before you rip it. Don't be murdered over your song before you ad-lib it. I pop up like a zibbit, but give it, I'm at your cribbit. Not to put no fucking fish tanks in your civet.
You heard Grafton say if he makes the final day of this tournament tomorrow, he's going to lose money because he can't put in a Sunday session online.
No, that can't be true. Grafton's certainly going to save money.
What's up, mate?
Not today. Maybe later. Yes, a little professional.
So, Lara. So, black tea with sugar and still water.
Fours for the party poker ambassador.
About this, just calls with pocket fours.
So here is the GTS solution for UTG plus one with 50 big blinds, and we see that although the solver is open raising with fours, it is not limping with any of its range. My understanding from Range Converter is that the solver doesn't begin to limp until around 27 or 28 big blinds. That being said, there are a few key points here we should note which may warrant deviating from this solution. For one, this solution assumes that all 8 players in the game have 50 big blinds, which obviously is not true in this case. And with that in mind, Patrick's actions before he decided to limp may give us some insights into his thinking. After checking his cards, Patrick takes a long look to his right, and then to his left. And then he takes another look back to the right, and then again to the left, before ultimately putting in his limp. So what was he looking at? Well, it may not be a coincidence that his gaze appeared to have been directed towards the 3 shortest stacks on the table. To Patrick's immediate left are the low jack with 14 big blinds and the high jack with 28 big blinds, and to Patrick's right is the big blind with 23 bigs. And while we don't know Pad's exact thought process here, these short stacks may be more incentivized to shove over an open raise compared to if he just limped, due to the increased pot size and decreased SPR resulting from a raise. Right, if we take a look at the GTO solution for a 25 big blind game, where the solver starts to have a limping range, we see that when UTG plus one limps, the solver is generally jamming with less frequency overall compared to when UTG plus one open raises. Also, it should be noted that the players have just entered the money with 76 being paid, which may cause the players to loosen up significantly, especially given the fact that pay jumps in this tournament are sporadic, where to get from the 20k min cash to a 60k payout, a player would need to place 11th. With all that in mind, Patrick may have limped here to keep the pot small with his marginal hand that should be able to comfortably call a standard 3-bet, but may be forced to fold to a shove.
Already developing a limping strategy.
Can I get a latte and a small bottle of water, please?
Wondering, keep an eye on what sorts of hands Leonard may opt to continue limping with. Is it always sort of these small pairs where we would like to limp and call ISO raises? Would he do it with ace-x suited? Would you ever consider limping some premiums from time to time just to balance it all?
Here comes Sam Grafton with King-Jack of spades out of the small blind.
Sam wants to find out. King-Jack suited.
The action folds around to Sam in the small blind, and he makes a 5 big blind raise. So it's tough to say what Sam's raising range is, given the differing stack sizes and the limp, but on the left is the GTO solution for the small blind in a 25 big blind game when UTG plus one limps, and to the right is the GTO solution for the small blind in an 80 big blind game when UTG plus one open raises. Given that Sam is around 80 big blinds deep here, it's probably safe to remove all of these jams we see in the 25 big blind solution and replace them with raises, calls, or folds. Additionally, it probably makes sense to remove some or all of these more marginal hands from his range that are present in the 80 big blind solution, such as suited connectors, which may be more inclined to call when facing a limp, as we see being done in the 25 big blind solution. Also, given Patrick's limp, Sam's raise size is smaller than a typical 3-bet size, so compared to the 80 big blind solution, we're going to include an increased raise frequency for some of these medium strength combos that are mostly raising in the 25 big blind solution facing a limp, but are doing some calling or folding in the 80 big blind range facing a raise, such as these suited broadways and stronger offsuit broadway combos.
Get this heads up against Patrick Leonard. Looks quite strong out of the small blind. Leonard plenty deep, in position with two fours.
Patrick will make the call.
The action folds back around to Patrick and he calls, which the solver is doing with 100% frequency with its remaining fours at 25 big blinds, and Patrick should be even more inclined to continue with his fours given the players are deeper than that with better implied odds. So again, it's hard to estimate what Patrick's calling range looks like in this specific spot, but this is the UTG plus one calling range after a limp and a small blind raise in a 25 big blind game. We see that this range is pretty merged as it includes strong, medium strength, and weaker holdings, which is likely structured for balance. Patrick may have a more polarized limping range where he's limping with his weakest and strongest hands only, but this range seems to be pretty reasonable, although of course it won't be an exact replication of Patrick's range in this scenario, so it should be taken with a grain of salt.
Sam Grafton, Patrick Leonard heads up to this flop. Comes ace-ace-eight with one spade. A couple backdoor draws for Grafton. Patrick Leonard's fours are best.
See if Grafton can piece this thing together. It looks to me like Leonard should have a lot of pairs that he's limp and then called a raise with. 15. This sort of small c-bet likely to just print money. Is Leonard going to give Sam Grafton a lot of respect for having an ace in his hand here to ISO from the small blind?
The flop comes ace, ace, eight, rainbow, and Sam continues with a small 20% pot bet. And we see that the solver is essentially betting its entire range on this flop, with either a 20% or a 33% pot bet. If we assume that Patrick would have open raised or limp 4-bet most of his strongest aces and pocket pairs, Sam should have a significant range advantage on this board. Additionally, when the player's ranges are relatively tight and the flop is paired, particularly when the paired card is high, the preflop aggressor will often retain his range advantage, mainly due to his strong pocket pairs, since it generally is less probable that either player has connected to the board. Right, if we take a look at 184 representative flops for a small blind versus cutoff 3-bet scenario without an ante, where the ranges are somewhat close to the assumed ranges here, we see that many of the boards where the small blind is checking least often are these paired boards. And we see that when the paired card is high, the solver appears to generally prefer a smaller sizing, which makes sense given that a higher card is more likely to hit the preflop aggressor's range, and the preflop caller will have relatively few marginal hands he can continue with on such a dry board, particularly with minimal or no overcard equity.
Range advantage, Grafton.
Bet is 380K.
Pads calls, and we see that most pairs are calling, all the way down to pocket deuces, although some pocket fours are beginning to fold. Despite the considerable range advantage enjoyed by Sam, this very small bet is giving Patrick a great price to continue, and Sam should have a lot of air here since nearly his entire range was betting. And we see that if instead of this small bet, Sam had bet full pot, most of these lower pairs are now folding. Interestingly, the solver is raising a decent amount of combos here, including pocket fours, and four of spades, four of hearts in particular, possibly because it blocks the ace-four suited combos in Sam's range. Although at an overall range disadvantage, the preflop caller should have a number of ace-x combos in his range as well, which should justify doing some check raising, both with value combos as well as some bluffs.
Leonard will come along.
Yeah, a little sneaky, maybe. Obviously trying to rep that ace. We know a four is good if he hits it.
Turn is the deuce of diamonds.
See, Squid is not done. He says, no, I've got this. I'm going to rep Ace King.
And bet 540,000.
Again, small sizing. Dial back all the way pre-flop where his open was to 800,000.
The turn is the deuce of diamonds and Sam barrels with another small 20% pot bet. Although Sam likely still retains a slight range advantage with the deuce being mostly a blank, Patrick's call on the flop should strengthen his range considerably, particularly since many of his marginal hands should have folded on the dry flop, and also he should have a number of ace-x combos that would have just flatted Sam's bet. And coupling this with the fact that Sam is out of position, it makes sense to add in a decent allocation of checks throughout his range. And so the next obvious question is, how do we determine the best way to distribute that mix of checks and bets? Well, focusing on these king-jack suited combos, we see that there is a pretty distinct dichotomy here, with the diamonds and hearts mostly betting, and the spades and clubs mostly checking. A couple weeks ago, we discussed how to identify ideal situations to continue to barrel. The most common scenario we discussed is where the hero turns a card favorable to his range or a draw, as is the case here with the diamonds. Another barreling candidate we mentioned was when hero is holding a faux flush draw, that is where hero is holding one suit of a flush draw that blocks and therefore can represent the flush on rivers where the flush completes, as we can see here with these offsuit holdings with one diamond. And if hero needs to find additional bluffs given the circumstances, a third way he can differentiate between good and bad barreling candidates is by choosing to barrel combos that unblock the weaker portion of villain's continuing range and to give up with combos that block the weaker portion of villain's continuing range. So in this case, the hearts are continuing to barrel, likely because they unblock a number of backdoor flush combos that the solver called with in Patrick's shoes on the flop. Right, if we take a look back, we see that facing Sam's small bet, the solver is calling a number of these higher suited Broadway combos when they contain a backdoor flush draw, but the solver is folding most of the combos with the hearts. So from a purely GTO standpoint, there's a clear preference to barrel when holding king-jack of diamonds or king-jack of hearts, but to mostly give up when holding king-jack of spades or king-jack of clubs, since the latter block a number of weaker Broadway with a backdoor type hands in Patrick's range, which in turn increases the probability that Patrick called on the flop holding an ace or a pair that will not be inclined to fold to this bet.
Look at this. Leonard just does not believe Squid.
Makes the call again.
Pretty remarkable.
Patrick calls, which again we see is consistent with the solver strategy, as virtually all of the remaining paired hands are calling this small bet.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, and river's a full house. Forceful for Patrick Leonard.
And two barrels by Squid. Let's see if he just decides to give up. No way do I think that Patrick Leonard is folding a number of rivers here. The backdoor diamonds came home.
Grafton again. Three barrels.
The river is the four of diamonds, and Sam completes his barrel with another small 21% pot bet. So with Patrick's two calls, this low river card, which favors Patrick's range, and the flush coming in, we see that the solver has now shifted to checking most of its range. Right, Patrick should have in his range a number of ace-x as well as flushes, and the four brings in some additional full houses as well. As a result, we see that Sam appears now to be at a significant range disadvantage, as reflected by the comparative equities and EVs. And if we take a look at the hotness chart, which shows all possible river runouts, we indeed see that the solver checks on most river cards containing a diamond or an 8, which Patrick should also have a good number of in his range. And not surprisingly, the small blind has more EV and equity on higher river cards as compared to lower river cards. As such, we see that the solver is not doing much betting at all, and therefore the solver prefers to allocate the few bluffs it can fire to the best possible bluff candidates, such as these King X combos that block the flush.
Grafton is again, he's just trying to tell that story that he has Ace King and he's betting all three streets with it. Leonard now, for the times that that is believable, improving to a full house, certainly should be going for more value with fours full.
He'll use a time extension, granting him an additional 30 seconds to act. What sizing will he choose here? Time bank used. To almost 4.5 million.
What do you make? Four's full on the hand.
4,450.
Sam even said his hand. Did you make four's full on the end?
Button's good.
Yeah. Pretty decent read, I would say, from Squid. Pretty decent pot, I would say, for Patrick Leonard, the Party Poker Ambassador.
So rivering the full house, Patch raises it up nearly full pot, and interestingly, we see that the solver is even more aggro, shoving with the fours. However, it should be noted that the solver isn't taking into account the fact that the players are in the money in a tournament, and instead it assumes that the game ends after this hand, so a shove in this spot may not be real life optimal. That being said, in any event, a large bet here is clearly warranted, likely in part due to the significant number of aces and flushes in Sam's range that should be able to call this bet. And taking a look at the range explorer, we see that all full houses and flushes are raising here, while most other holdings simply call or fold on this paired and flushed board, other than these lower pairs and missed Broadway holdings, which have minimal showdown value and are therefore transformed into bluffs. So in this video, we witnessed a delicate game of chicken between two players with marginal holdings on a very dangerous board. On the one hand, Sam triple barreled with a naked bluff, apparently relying purely on his initial range advantage. And on the other hand, Patrick hung in there with his low pair facing several small bets, and his resilience ultimately rewarded him with a decent sized pot late in the tournament. So that's the video for today. Thanks for watching, and until next time, stay balanced.
Haven't y'all all heard what? Y'all all herbs. Yeah. I stick toothpicks and y'all all derbs. Listen, I'm a shark. Y'all just koi fish. What else? Octopus. What else? Oysters.